It's time. BBC, Jamie here. Hope everyone is doing well. So, today I'm really happy to say that I've been asked to contribute to the Great Blue Note 4000 series. And the album that I've been asked to speak about is this one. It is Jackie McLean's It's Time, number 4179. Now, first things first, I want to start off with the title, It's Time. And the thing that always comes to mind when I see it is asking the question, it's time for what? And really, to me, there are two things that this title is really saying. Now, the first is very much in the context of when it was recorded. It was released in 1965, but it was actually recorded the year prior in August of 1964. And it was just 4 weeks after Lyndon Johnson had signed the Civil Rights Act into law on the 2nd of July. So during this whole period, McLean's music was really, really heavily invested and engaged with the politics of the civil rights movement. And if you think about albums like Let Freedom Ring, of course, which really kicked off this series of more avant-garde records by McLean, Right Now that follows this as well, Destination Out, all of these albums have a connection with not just the avant-garde music, but very much with the politics that are going on in and around the music that's being created. McLean talks about this actually to great effect in the Ken Burns series. He says that everything that was happening around him, he felt that the music just had to go that way too. Similarly, there's a NPR podcast where he speaks to Terry Gross, and he said that very, very explicitly when he recorded Let Freedom Ring, he wanted it to be seen as a part of the greater civil rights movement. That freedom that he heard in the music of the likes of Ornette Coleman that really caused a massive change in direction for him musically, he saw that freedom of expression artistically being entirely mirrored with the freedom for African Americans and their rights within the US. So that's the first thing I think of it when I see It's Time. And you look at this cover, this incredible cover by Reed Miles, one of his greatest, I think. But on here, you have 244 exclamation marks. You know, it's time. It's not a question. It's not a request. It's a statement. It's declamatory. It's a demand. It is time. You know, the time has come. And that really comes across in the music here. The second thing to say is, I think It's Time, to me, also indicates a little bit of a rising tide of younger musicians. And it being their time, it's their time. McLean was a fantastic supporter and exponent of young musicians. He brought through the likes of Tony Williams, Jack DeJohnette, gave some breaks to Bobby Hutcherson, Gratian Moncur III. And again here, he has predominantly a roster of young, very young in some cases, musicians, or debutantes on the label. So on this album with him is the stalwart Roy Haynes. He's the veteran of the group here, and he's only 39, so not much of a veteran, but fresh off the Destination Out sessions. You also have Cecil McBee on bass, who is 30, but this is his first record with Blue Note and only his third or fourth recording session. Previously, he'd been playing with the Paul Winter group. There's young Herbie Hancock, 25 years old. 2 weeks prior to this session, he recorded The Great Empyrean Isles, but he's also right at the cutting edge with Miles Davis, just before Wayne Shorter has joined the group at this point, making the likes of albums like Four More, Seven Steps to Heaven. And then the big bolter on this, really, to me, is the young Charles Tolliver. Tolliver is 22 years old on this recording, but it's not just his youthfulness that's worth noting. It's the fact that this is his first recording session ever, and he still contributes 3 of the 6 compositions, which to me is absolutely remarkable. Now, there's a fantastic interview with Tolliver that's done by the British broadcaster Giles Peterson, which I'll leave a link to below, and he talks about the experience of of meeting Jackie McLean and appearing on the session. And Tolliver was playing at Slugs, which he was a regular player at during that time. And he was approached by a member of the Jackie McLean fan club who suggested that he paid McLean a visit. So Tolliver went to McLean's house. He was given his address. Jackie McLean was in one of his many periods of trying to kick addiction. And he visited him on his doorstep and was invited in. And McLean asked him if he had any tunes, and he said yes, he had a few. And so he asked him, are you free for a recording session on this date? And Tolliver said, yes, sure, of course. And lo and behold, it happened. McLean never heard him play. He didn't ask him to audition for him in the room. He just invited him along to a session at Blue Note with the likes of Roy Haynes, Cecil McBee, Herbie Hancock, and said, I'll give you half of the compositional billing on this record. To me, it's absolutely remarkable. It speaks of McLean not only as someone who had a gut instinct for people who had something about them as a person, but also his ongoing willingness to support young musicians. And it's no surprise that later in his career, into the 1970s, Jackie McLean became a university college educator. That really became his bread and butter for making his way in life. So to the music. And the music here, I think, is absolutely fantastic. Now, to me, this, I've seen a few reviews giving it a little bit of a, not a bad rap, but almost describing it as a step back from Destination Out or One Step Beyond, the two albums that came previous to this. To me, I think that's completely unfair. They're almost like comparing apples and oranges to me. You know, Destination Out, One Step Beyond are astonishing records. But to me, they're almost like a musical form of abstract expressionism, right? They're like a Rothko painting. There's this deep floating abstraction to them, particularly with Hutcherson's vibes and Moncur's trombone. They sort of float there and they draw you in this really, really hypnotic way. This to me is more like impressionism. It is fast moving. It has a lot of tiny brush strokes that are very active to listen to, but create this amazingly organic and engaging whole. And actually, in a way, the cover sort of reflects that a bit too, doesn't it? It almost looks like the dashes of a brush on the canvas. And it sounds like that to my ears. Partly that's Roy Haynes. Roy Haynes' style, he just dances all over a drum kit and creates this amazing circular rhythm. And with Herbie Hancock on the piano underneath, who's just the most inventive, supportive accompanist. I mean, his solos on this are fantastic, but honestly, his comping behind the soloing here is really something to hear. So yeah, to me, it's not a step back at all. It's almost it's a broadening of the palette, and using different sounds to still explore the freedom that McLean really wants to in his music. I mean, the opening track is called Cancellation, and Tolliver talks about it as being a way of signifying a cancellation of the music that has come before. I mean, again, if you want to come back to what I was saying about It's Time, you know, they are saying that was then, this is now, it's our time. And so that piece almost churns in a circular way. It's dancing, but almost around the beat and around the melody. There's Revelot, which is a Tolliver composition as well, Tolliver spelt backwards, which to me is probably my favorite piece on here. It's really, really declamatory horn lines on that. And actually the best stuff on here to me is actually hearing Tolliver and McLean's horns in tandem with one another. They have a beautiful synergy with each other. And when they're going through these kind of knotty heads before they move into the solos, it's just, yeah, it's really, really exciting. There's also a fantastic ballad by Tolliver, Truth, which appears on a couple of his later Strata E sessions, which is a nice balance to what otherwise is a pretty up-tempo, frenetic album. There is a McLean Blues on here as well, Das Dat, which is great too. But to me, it's the Tolliver compositions that really, really shine. And yeah, I mean, for a kid who's never played in a recording session, never played in front of McLean before, to have been given that break, I mean, that's something else, isn't it? It's a remarkable story. It's a great story behind what I think is a really, really strong, really, really strong Jackie McLean album on a phenomenal run on the Blue Note label. So that is my roundup of that fantastic McLean record. Thank you for watching. If you made it all the way through, hope you found that interesting. And hopefully I'll be making more of these again soon. So until next time, take care and look after yourselves. Cheers.